Well, that being said, oh.
So, everybody please welcome Ricky! Woo! If it's not obvious, if it's not comfortable, you can also move it like this. You have coffee, water?
Yeah, I feel like I'm going to sleep, I'm going to test
you. Okay, Ricky. Thanks for joining us. You actually hear the microphone. So, I'm interested in not so much about your life in the beginning. I want to go right into the topic, you know? So, for example, what I would like to know is, what do you think is the finance industry in China or specifically in Chengdu like?
The lifestyle in Chengdu is pretty much laid back. And we enjoy the life here, and we walk slowly, we work slowly, and the pressure is much less. So, in my opinion, the financial industry here is moving very fast. Okay. There's a lot of space we can do in the future. And the products we have here in Chengdu, in China, are not as many as what we used to have in the US. So in my opinion, there's a long way to go. And we are at the right beginning.
Okay, you know, as you experienced the financial crisis in America, what do you think about the situation in China? Like, did it impact the Chinese market a lot? Do you think maybe another bubble coming up here? Because a lot of institutions, they're growing like immensely here now. So can you maybe draw some like similarities or differences?
Sure. Let's talk about the housing market here. And I believe everybody has some feeling that the housing bubble is coming or not. I have a strong feeling in the future. I'm not quite sure if that's tomorrow or 10 years down the way, but there will be a huge correction in the housing market because that's the rule that every country or every district should follow, okay? Because of the government control, we do not have that correction coming yet. But in my opinion, it's going to happen no matter when. Because let's talk about the financial crisis in the US. That was because everybody thinks we have the limited land. And the population is growing, and the land is going to be less per person. Therefore, the value of the property should increase every year. But if that's the simple as ABC, I mean, we should not go to college, right? I mean, there's no meaning that we issue some certificates or the all kinds of securities to trade, right? So I'm not quite sure what, but I believe we will see a huge correction. Let's see the housing, the value of the properties in Shanghai and Beijing is way too much, okay? And I believe we just need something to trigger, to push the button. Therefore, we will see a correction. I'm not saying there will be a crash, but there may be a huge correction because people cannot afford. If we cannot afford something, nobody's going to buy or trade. I mean, due to the less demand, the value will just decrease. That's my opinion.
But don't you think because of the urbanization in China, which is still quite low compared to America, Europe, that more and more people will move into the cities, and that's why the demand is actually will grow also in the next years?
I agree. That's a good point. Well, due to more people moving into the city, there will be an increase for the demand. But, I mean, for the next generation, let's say for the people born in 80s or in 70s, we have probably more than two or three properties already, right? So we can imagine 10 years later or 20 years later, we have four or five apartments or house in our hands. And who's going to buy? I mean, we're talking about the marginal demand, right? I mean, people, like, I mean, the young generation here will have 3 or 5 apartments, and for your kids, are you going to buy, I mean, more properties? Okay, so the demand will be less. And by the way, I mean, so that's the first reason. I mean, second, okay, I mean, more people are moving from the suburban to the city, right? I mean, they're going to pay more. I mean, but the income that they're making are not supported. I mean, they cannot afford those like high-flight buildings here. So, I mean, I would say that's a very few people who can afford those very expensive properties, especially in Beijing, Shanghai.
Okay, you know, a lot of industries are moving now into the technology-based sector, health industry, education industry, of course also the financial industry. So I would like to ask you, how do you compare the fintech industry in Chengdu or China compared to the global situation?
When I was working in the financial industry, I was working 80 hours per week. That was like 5 days per week. But when I was working in the big data or the IT industry, I was working 100 hours. So I think that's much tougher. But now I'm working with the big data in the financial industry. I'm working 120 hours. That's the horrible life. Okay? So I would say the fintech industry right now in China is just at the beginning. And for the past 5 years, each country or other financial and all financial institutions, they started to spend more money on the financial technology. For example, JP Morgan Chase, the biggest bank in terms of the assets in the US, they have some program called COIN, C-O-I-N. That program is doing what? They use the AI, the artificial intelligence, to replace the human work, okay? They use those technology to replace the lawyers and the bankers work from 330,000 hours into seconds, which means they can use the fintech technology to do the normal job in seconds. Less pressure, more accuracy. So that's the trend. So going forward, we will see more jobs will be replaced, let's say in Wall Street, more jobs will be replaced by the machines.
So it's good that you actually moved out of the industry.
Well, I mean, I would say, I believe everybody heard about something called programming trading, right? I mean, in terms of the programming trading, I mean, the machine has no emotions, okay? I've been through all the financial crises in the US, in China, but I have some emotions. I mean, sometimes when I have loss, I wanna see a rebound, and I hope for the best and prepare for the worst. But in the reality, it's not like this, right? When I have a loss, I should cut my loss. But the reality is that loss is going to be deeper and deeper. I suffer more. So I'm not the machine. I have the motion. I have the emotion. So if I have the programming training, so I will cut my loss right away and let my profit run. So I would say programming training is part of how the machine will replace the human work.
Interesting. 就是简单的跟大家总结一下。 刚才杜总分享的这些问题，都是首先我们就是想了解一下，金融科技它在中国的一个处在一个什么阶段，和世界比起来它处在一个什么阶段。就是现在中国的金融科技它还是处在一个初期，相对于其他发达的国家，所以说还是有很多很好的机会。然后现在美国最大的一个银行就是那个摩根 JP Morgan， 然后他们有一个项目叫什么呢？叫 COIN C O I N。
然后他们在做什么呢？就是用 AR， 就是人工智能来取代现在银行的那些在做 trade 的人的工作。就是说他们现在银行已经开始慢慢的转型，让更多的 AI 的人工智能的技术植入到他们的领域。但是即便所有的效率都能够上去，但是人工智能它不能取代的就是人类所带来的一个情感的问题。就是说你在任何的职业生涯中，你都会有一个情感的一个归宿在你的任何的一个工作中，这个是人工智能不能取代的。所以说这个就是刚才顾总分享的一个简单的一个小总结。
Okay, cool. Yeah, I want to move a bit now to big data. So, from your words, I would like to know, how do you define big data, and what do you think, how will it change our lives? And also, why did you decide to move into this sector, you know?
That's a good question. Big data, in my view, is a group of all kinds of data formats, including text, video, voice, and graphic, and everything. We collect and analyze those data in order to make a better prediction in the future. I mean, because the more information or the data we have, and we can analyze, the more accurate results we can get, the much better decision we can make in the future. So for example, if a bunch of people are using Google to search for a certain disease in a certain area, okay, I bet 99% of the time the disease will happen in that area, because that's the application of the big data. We can use the data to predict how our behaviors will be. And the data can help us to make a better decision. And I bet everybody knows the application called Airbnb from US, and also the DD, that's the car application we use in China, right? I mean, those two examples are great application of the sharing economy. But in my view, they are also a good example of the big data, because they know what is the time or how often I use the car from my apartment to the airport. Okay. For example, I fly to Shanghai every week. I fly to Shanghai on Monday and get back on Friday. So DD, the application, all right, the car application will have my data. Therefore, they can analyze what is your frequency and how many people like Ricky Gu are flying from Chengdu to Shanghai on a weekly basis. You can imagine what they can do. If I were Chen Wei, the co-founder of of the DD car, I would make a very brave move. I would just have a private jet or something, right? And try to call those people, hey, you guys fly from Chengdu to Shanghai, let's have a jet for you guys. Okay, that's the application we can use, because the data they have is a massive data. And if you dig into the data, you'll find a very valuable information.
Cool, so actually it's generating a lot of new business models. Why did you decide to move into big data?
Because that's the trend, okay? I mean, I moved into this industry 3 years ago. Well, I was talking to one of my friends here, and I was talking to him. I said, I would like to learn something very new, and that's the clear trend in the future, including the cloud computing, the Internet of the Thing, as well as the big data. So that was just, my luck that I met a master of the big data in China. His name is Zhou Tao, and he's the youngest professor in China, and he's very intelligent and smart. So 3 years ago, I met with Kim, and we discussed about the futures of the big data. And so we founded this company, and 3.5 years later, we're here. We started from 30,000 RMB for the initial capital. And right now, the valuation of my company is 1.8 billion RMB. That has been increased 30,000 times for the past 3.5 years.
That's quite amazing. Okay. Thank you. So one thing I want to say is, you know, a lot of organizers in Chengdu who want to organize international events, you know, they are missing out amazing people like Ricky Gu. Chengdu actually has a lot of amazing entrepreneurs who are doing good things, you know, and I'm really happy to have you here tonight.
startup grind 就是一个价值观吧。所以说刚才顾总分享了这么多，我觉得简单的来说就是大数据是什么。可能大家在网上呀，在报纸上呀，在传媒上呀，都在说大数据大数据，隔壁大妈都说我懂大数据。其实大数据顾总的分析就是说，大数据它是说你今天所做的每一件事，你只要用了手机了，你做的每一个决定，它都是一个数据的收集。这个数据的收集就可以预测出你的行为，这个就是 behavior science， 就是说通过数据来推测你今天会去哪儿，你明天会买什么，你喜欢什么，这个就是大数据的真正的魅力所在。所以说顾总也是在3年前开启了这个大数据的这样一条非常有前景的这样的一个职业取向。所以说我觉得真正的大数据其实就是我们现在用手机用了这么多，然后WeChat微博这些都是大数据。我们每个人做的每一个决定，它都是一个数据的收集。数据的收集是为了什么？是能够给你带来一个更好的一个推测，它知道你想要什么了，想得到什么了，直接就推送给你了。所以说你就不用再去做这样的筛选了，这个就是大数据的魅力。
Right. I also know that BBD Business Big Data is especially focusing like at least one of your parts in the financial sector. So as far as I know, it's quite difficult for SMEs to get loans from banks, because banks, you know, they cannot really estimate the risk. And you know, then the kind of shadow banking came up, so companies were getting loans from very shady like organizations. And I got to know that actually you can help these financial institutions now to make these kind of decisions. Can you explain how you're using big data now to enable financial institutions to make decisions to give or give not loans?
That's a very interesting question. Actually, we are the first company in China who designed the credit rating models to work with the banks. To help those small and the micro entities to get the loans. Okay, the way how it works in the past, all the banks, they do not want to issue those loans to a small-sized company, because you do not have the credit, you don't have the collaterals, you don't have the properties, right? And the only thing you have is just a bunch of tables and a group of people. So for banks, they don't really care. They say, you don't have cars, you don't have the land, how can I give you the money, right? But things could be changed. How that works right now is, we talk to the bank, we said, look, okay, I will help you to picture the entrepreneurs, the owners, right? So for example, Roy was the owner of the ABC company, all right? So I would tell the bank, I said, well, I know something about him because he used to buy something on Taobao, or so I can get his address, all right? The address I get, I can analyze which area he's living in, right? Is he living in the southern part? So I can know he's gonna be rich, right? If he lives in the northern part, I was like, okay, he should be okay, right? So that's one thing. And second, I can get some data from his network. I will say, okay, how many friends do you have? And what are they in some industries? Let's say all his friends are in the real estate market or in the banking industry. I know his, he is at least the middle class, right? So I can plug in more data to help the banks to further determine his class and his capacity and ability to repay the loans. So the data I bring in are helping those banks make better decision. Therefore, banks will say, look, okay, now we say the risk are controlled and we can eliminate those risks by issuing Mr. Roy 30,000 RMB at the beginning. So we help the banks to do the business. The banks will appreciate the data we bring in. Therefore, banks are willing to pay us a certain fee, right? So I help the banks to win more customers and to issue more loans. So that's how it works. But in the past, because we have no data about Mr. Roy itself, so we cannot make a decision. Banks will say, no way. We only deal with the China Mobile or some big firms, all right? For your small firms, we're not going to issue any loan. So, but things are changing right now. So this is how it works.
I think actually for the whole Chinese economy, you're like doing a big head now. Thank you for this again. Can you maybe say again how much money you raised because of your service for the SMEs?
We issued the first product back to the 18th of July 2016 in Chongqing. Chongqing Bank is the first bank that we work with. For the past 7 months, we have issued more than 1 billion RMB for SMEs. And now we are working with more banks, including Guiyang Bank and Changsha Bank and more regional banks in China. And we believe our service can add some value for the banks and can help them to issue more loans to the SMEs.
Yeah, awesome. So a lot of entrepreneurs that have their big dreams, now because of you, they're able to get their loans. You know, me being a German, like, to listen to all your stories, you know, you can get the data here and there. It's actually a little bit scary, you know, that you know so many things about somebody. So I have a question. Do you think having access to big data is easier in China because privacy laws are not as strict here? Or do you think it's more difficult because the government is actually regulating and controlling a lot?
The most valuable data in China are controlled by the government. But going forward, the government is going to release the data as time goes by. Therefore, as a service provider, the third-party service provider, we see this opportunity in the future. Because the government, once they have the data, they need someone to work with, okay? To analyze the data, to do more the algorithm, and to set up or to provide more service and the products, okay? But, I mean, by contrast, it's not like in other countries, let's say in the US or in the UK, I mean, people can easily access the data or the information from the website or from the government, all kinds of the bureaus. But in China, it's my opinion that government is going to release this data as time goes by. Therefore, we can, once we have this opportunity and we can get those data and work with the government to design a better and more workable products to help the financial institutions as well as other institutions, let's say for the education or for the hospital and for every industry that needs the big data.
简单跟大家总结一下刚才杜总跟那个顾总分享，就是说他们BBD呢，其实做一个大数据在帮SME，就是微小型企业，做这个大的银行做这样的一个合作方式，通过建立一个信誉体制来给他们借贷款，就是说 FinTech 就是金融科技它的走向是什么，就是说一些以前没有信用机制。 没有信用的这个体系的话，那么银行是不能把钱借给微小型企业的。所以说他们去，所以说 BBD 现在用大数据创造了这样的一个体系过后，这样银行就会有更多的数据去检测这个企业我能不能借给他钱。所以说，BBD 他们去年和重庆就做了开始了第一笔合作，然后到至今大概借给微小型企业大概借了1亿人民币。所以说，这样的一个方式其实是更多的在帮创业家做他们想做的事情，就是因为没有信誉的体制的话，那么你很难去了解他如果真正的需要钱，然后你又不知道他们的信誉是什么样的话，连 作为一个银行也很难借给他们，所以说拥有了更多的大数据的话，实际上就可以让这些微小型的企业有更多的信誉，信用价值，所以说他们也可以更快的拿到这份的钱，然后去做他们想做的事情。Okay,
so does this mean me being a startup, if I go to one of the banks you are cooperating with, it's more likely that I get a loan?
Well, I would say the odds are much better than we used to be, right?
Okay, that's good. All right, let's move a bit back to 2007 or when you lived in the USA. Because, I mean, when we were talking to you the first time, you know, as soon as you mentioned, oh, actually, you know, I worked at the Wall Street when the financial crisis happened, I was like, oh, really? Tell us more about it, you know? And you even used to work in one of the banks who failed, you know? Can you go back and maybe explain what happened at that time, you know, when you saw the bubble coming, and then I know that you decided to leave one of the banks. Like, what made you making this decision?
That was a long, long time ago. 10 years ago, that was, I would say, how time flies. I worked with Bear Stearns. I entered into Bear Stearns back to 2006. That was the best year in our company history. I clearly remember the share price of our company. The stock price was $183 per share at the peak. That's the end of 2006. That was my lucky number. And I don't know why you cannot go any higher. But ever since 2006, the market just changed its direction, right? Starting from 2007, the Federal Reserve start to cut the interest. And the interest rate, it's way beyond people's imagination, but it still cannot save the market. And there was one person on Wall Street called John Paulson, all right? And he is the only person who made billions and billions US dollars. And I saw him once in Central Park running with a lot of pressure. You can imagine, all right? And if all of us are betting the markets keep going higher, and he jumps out and say, you people are very stupid, all right? And I bet the market is going to change, and you should short it. And you can imagine what we can tell him. All right, get out of here, right? So he has a lot of pressure. He started to initial the short positions by using a lot of older derivatives called CDS. But the market still keep going up, all right? Until the middle of 2007, and the correction started to come, and he started to make money. So, at the beginning of 2007, as a trader, our trading desk issued 70% of the mortgage-backed security loans in the world. So 70% of the mortgage-backed security loans were issued from our trading desk from Bear Stearns. I saw the profit loss. It's not the profit. I saw the loss come in every day. It's more than $10 million for a long time. I started to realize something could happen. All right. So as a foreigner, I started to look for jobs, right? I smell something is going to happen, and I don't know what, and I don't know what will happen, but I just don't feel good. So I made several phone calls to the headhunters on Wall Street. I still remember the headhunter's name is Alex. Can't remember her last name, but the first name is Alex. She spent 7 months helping me land my second job. And so I moved to Deutsche Bank at the end of 2007. Okay, 3 months later, which was March 2008, all right, my MD, the managing director of Deutsche Bank, his name is Alan, he threw the newspaper on my desk, said, Ricky, you are a lucky bastard. I'm like, what happened? So he goes, look at the news. Bear Stearns was fucked. Wow, really? But he used to work with Bear Stearns. So I was like, wow, thank you for bringing me here. Right? So I was telling him, well, the market is crashed. And everybody's trying to sell, and nobody's trying to get the price. It looks like all of us are selling, pushing the button to sell, and nobody is willing to buy. You can imagine what happened to the price of the assets. All right. Let me just tell everybody a little story about how this works. When we pull all the mortgage-backed securities together, we sell that to the financial institutions, let's say including the AIG, the insurance company, the investment banks, and all the hedge funds, or blah, 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 okay. So when they buy our products, okay, they want to have something to hedge, right? Therefore, they will buy some derivatives in order to hedge. Some derivatives they use will be the interest rate swaps, or the CDS, which is the credit default swaps. Okay. So what happened is this, if all the people, they declined to make the payment on a monthly basis, the value of the mortgage will get sour, right? Because nobody's going to pay, so the value will drop. So for people who already have those mortgage-backed securities, the value will decrease too. Therefore, it will have a chain reaction, right? So everybody who has this mortgage-backed security, those loans, will suffer a loss. By using the derivatives, let's say the CDS, I mean, it has a leverage of more than 10 or 20, which means if you have a loss of 1 billion, that will be 20 billion. So that's a huge number, and that will destroy you in 1 second. Okay, so for that time, JP Morgan Chase came in and arranged by the Federal Reserve, said, okay, why not talk to Bear Stearns and you guys should merge together. So they make us an offer. They were willing to pay $2 per share. And our stock price was $183 per share. And that's me. And the JP Morgan Chase came in, well, I'd like to pay you guys $2. So the chairman of our company said, look guys, the headquarters, 383 Madison, this building was worth much more than $10 per share. What the fuck are you guys talking about? So he was like, well, okay, let's redo the deal. Then they negotiate again. Finally, they made the deal, $10 per share. Right? So Bear Stearns merged with JP Morgan Chase. 14,000 employees were cut half. Half of them were laid off. Another 7,000 were merged and moved into JP Morgan Chase. Okay, and a half year later, which was September 2008, Lehman Brothers came in and said, well, Federal Reserve, if you save the Bear Stearns ass, you should save us, right? But Federal Reserve said, no way, I'm not gonna save you guys, you're living on your own. So I was looking from the Deutsche Bank building, and in front of us, that was the Lehman Brothers building. On that day, I saw more than 15,000 employees were cut off. They got laid off, and everybody moved out of the building with their box. And that was, you know, the horrible thing that I can ever think of. And you can imagine that when the market crashed and nobody is buying, and the price of all those assets were dropping like a hell. So that's what happened in the financial crisis back to 2008. And it took America more than, well, I'm gonna say 9 years until now, they're still under the recovery, right? So that was the time that we see how the greed will have some big impact on people's trading. And when the market gets irrational and the people do not care what happens, they just sell. And the price will drop like hell. This was what happened back that time. And time flies that 10 years later, and I'm still here.
我有一个问题，就是当你看到 Lehman Brothers 这么多人被 lay off， 然后你当时的一个很触动的一个感受是什么？就是你会害怕吗？然后还是说你会觉得没有安全感？还是说你会觉得，我现在在做的这个就是一个梦，你知道吗？就觉得这个太不真实了。我觉得特别想知道你当时看到那一幕的时候，脑子在想什么。
Back to that time, I never experienced something like that. And I lost some money, and our trading desk lost a lot of money, and our company got merged by JP Morgan Chase, and I jumped into Deutsche Bank. Deutsche Bank is a bank from Germany, and they had less exposure to the subprime loan. Therefore, they are in a better position. However, they still suffer a lot of loss. And I could say I was in deep fear at that time because people were just suffering a lot of loss. And I saw people go to suicide, and I saw people just killing themselves. And they have so many debts, and they don't know how they have the ability to pay that off. So the atmosphere was in a deep fear back that time. And I feel like I was dreaming, right? But however, I calmed down, and I survived. And when I look at that 10 years ago, I still don't believe that could happen in the US. Because in China, the government will ask you to put some down payment when you buy the property, right? At least 30% or 20% when the market was valued, right? So they want to make sure you have the ability to repay that in the future. But in the US, they're like, okay, they don't really care about if you have the jobs or not. They just believe the market will just keep going up because the land is limited and the people are growing. So the property should just start to increase as time goes by. That's not correct, right? It's all because of the demand and the supply. When you have a much better supply, which means that's a surplus, the price will drop. That's very simple idea, right? So when I look back that time, and luckily I survived, and we paid I would say that was a horrible lesson to all the people involved. And I would say the leverage is good in a certain, in a certain way. But be careful out there. Just like Warren Buffett said, I mean, all the true leverage are massive weapons. If you use that, you gotta be careful about that.
Interesting. 就简单跟大家分享一下刚才杜总分享的，就是其实我自己也是一个从美国留学回来的一个人，其实每一个留学生他都有一个梦想，就是去华尔街工作，华尔街其实是真的很难很难进的一个职业，就是说如果你真的是想去银行的话，华尔街可能就是你，如果你在那边。 可能工作一到两年，你的经验、你的工作职业经历的话，就会非常非常的棒。所以说，能够进入华尔街已经是一件很难的一件事情了。然后，所以说，顾总，我觉得很精彩、很棒的一点，就是说，在那个时候能够进入到华尔街，而且在五大银行中去工作，然后不断的成长。 然后去建立见证了美国金融的这样的一个衰败，所以说他也是非常明智的，就是 sense 到就感觉到了在2007年可能会有一些不一样的地方，然后他需要去改变，所以说他才会说跳槽。其实国外的人在就是我们中国人或者说移民的这些小伙伴们在国外跳槽是一件。 很难很难的事情，就是说我们是用的工作签证，然后工作签证如果要跳槽的话，就是会去转工作签证，所以说这一个 process 这个过程是非常辛苦的，因为我自己也是过来人吧，所以说我觉得这一路我觉得我很能够体会，就是顾总在那个时候在华尔街最优秀的一个群体当中，然后要去跳槽，然后去寻找工作，然后去建立去找下家，这是一个。 就是说很难去想象的一个事情，然后所以说我觉得当时顾总在分享的过程中，就整个就能够看到雷曼 Brothers 他们倒闭，然后这么多人在那一天，可能大家如果回忆得起来的话，就是报纸上也是有很多人拿着纸箱子，然后就走出了这个他们的公司的大门，然后这个算是一个盛景了。所以说，我觉得这个经历真的是非常非常的有意思，我自己是觉得。
Also, as you said, time flies, but I want to ask one more question. With your background, I think you are a very successful entrepreneur. You sold already one company successfully, you're building up another one, which is already valued at 1.8 billion, maybe next year, 10.8 billion, who knows. Do you have any advice for people who are right now building their companies, and from your background, like, any advice how to raise money if they're active in the area of big data or fintech? Is there anything you want to give them on their way?
I have to say, if you want to raise more money and look for more connections, you guys should come here and drink more coffee. because here is a wonderful place that provide a good opportunity for people to network. And especially with a wonderful organization like Startup Grind, Roy and Eric can help you guys raise more money. And by the way, and obviously, when you are trying to do something in China in those days, I mean, the business atmosphere, the environment is very competitive. And it's, well, I mean, I will always say, if you want to do something in China, you gotta, you know, work hard, long hours, and move fast, raise money, and protect your copyright, a lot of things. I mean, it's totally different from what we used to do in the US or in other countries. And I have to say, choose some industries that will have a clear trend. Let's say, I mean, the AI or AR, VR, or all those technology-driven industry, in my perspective, because those technology will definitely change our daily life in the future. And you will see the value of those companies just increase like hell. And also try to network. Yeah, because when I was in college in the US, and my professor always told us, okay, networking or not working. So I mean, that's the importance of the networking. And it's always good to network with people from all different industry, because the experience and the skills we gain can be easily transferred from one industry to another one. And we need to have a well-rounded person in the future in order to survive and to make the company moving ahead. And by the way, the Business Big Data, the BBD, has another meaning. When I founded that company, I would like to say, well, it's building big dreams, because we want to use the big data technology to dramatically change our life.
Cool. I think that's a good takeaway, networking or not working. So yeah, now we have the Q&A session. So 现在我们就到我们的讨论的时间。 Shay or Wendy, so who has a question? You can use English, Chinese.
I have a question about, as people and businesses are becoming much more global and less bound to one place, you've got these online banks. You've got like Monies, 126, whatever. Some of them are backed for $3 million, others for $15 million, but the people behind them are often really random entrepreneurs. And all the money is regulated by authorities and they can't reinvest your money, so it should be safe. But what do you think are the biggest risks for people like us to keep a lot of money on like online banks for business or as a consumer?
So your question is like how we, so I'm not quite sure, so what are you trying to say?
So nowadays you have online banks, they're basically, they're startup businesses, but they're not like traditional banks because they don't have any branch, they just keep your money in some safe, and it's regulated by some sort of authority from whatever country it is in. So basically all the money is kept in an app, and you don't need any, you can set up an account just by calling someone on the internet. So and these people, you can't get any interest on that money, so it's only for doing transactions. So they cannot reinvest your money, so you don't get interest on it. But the people behind these companies are very random entrepreneurs, like they're just like young guys like us. So what would you say are the biggest risks for us to use this kind of company, even though it's safe?
Okay, so the first suggestion will be use some products from the big data companies to access the credit risk, right? Second, I put very small portion of cash into the banks, no matter it's online banking system or the physical banks, because I think, well, we can always increase value of the cash we have. Like in China, I mean, we have the limited method or the ways to invest our money, but you still can have some opportunities to have a higher yield. other than putting your money into the banks. So I have to say, withdraw the portion of your money and do some investment. But before that, use some credit rating from the big data company to access the risk.
对，刚才啊，那个帅哥他就是问了一个问题，问什么呢？就是说传统行业的银行和网上银行、互联网的银行有什么有什么区别？然后最大的那个危机是什么？然后刚才顾总就解释了一下，就是说其实网上银行呢，虽然说没有传统银行这么有可以就是说摸看得着看得见摸得着的这样的一个实体，然后所以说我们在选用每一个银行网上互联网的银行的时候，去更多的去需要去看它有没有一个信用体制，然后也是需要用大数据去看这样的互联网的银行值不值得我们去用，因为这样的互联网的银行可能会涉及到很多我们不为人知的一些数据的收集呀，然后一些危险性的存在。Any other questions? Robert.
Hello, Rick. Thank you for the sharing. Basically, I'm thinking that is that the possibility is that because you have the access of the comprehensive and confidential data back in your person, so that you made the right decision to leave the investment bank.
Back to that time, I had no idea what was big data. So I just have the feeling something was not right, and I have to move.
But that because you access of the data?
Sure, I mean, we were experiencing more than $10 million loss every day for quite a long time. And I was asking myself,what will happen if we're still doing this? So I feel something is not right. So I decided to leave.
Right. So if with the use of the service you are providing now, do you think that this tragedy of the crisis crunch, the credit crunch of the triggered by the CBS 24th book, can be somehow avoided in your service?
I think that's a different scenario. Well, I mean, the financial crisis back 2008 was because of the high leverage and also the chain reaction. That had a massive impact, and from one institution to another, and it's like it's like the market crash, and nobody can survive. But right now, the data or the service we provide is we can better protect or predict the future. And it's kind of like, it's more like the proactive, I could say it's a proactive approach, right? We could do something in advance.To prevent what will happen. I mean, back that time, that was already there, and we do not have that information of what's going to drive the market in the future. But right now, if you ask me what can we do with our big data service, I could say it's helping all the institutions and companies and also individuals to make better decisions.Because the more information you get, the more accurate photo or picture you can draw, that you know more and better about the individual or the company or the institution. Therefore, you can control your risk and make a better decision.
Yeah, but just like 10 years ago, I guess those three famous agencies, like rating agency, was in the plane because they didn't.Really give a right rating for those products and the directives. So with those data, maybe they can do better?
Well, that's a very interesting question. They have very accurate data already, but due to the business models, all right, they are paid by those investment banks to give a rating. Therefore, if you were them, what would you do? If I pay you money to give a higher rating, you will just give the money and do it, right? So, because when we look back and we talk to the S&Ps and the Fitch and also the Moody's, we say, hey, why you guys have a triple A's for those loans? You know that's a very bad loans and they cash out. They said, okay, well, everybody gives that rating. No, that is not the truth. Because they were paid to give such a rating. Because they have they have the perception the market is never going to crash. When the market crashed, and everybody would like to find out some excuse, why you give them the AAA rating? Then they say, oh, well, I mean, just because everybody's doing something, I give them the AAA rating. But they did it on purpose. I know this. They were paid to do so. I mean, they are a bunch of greedy assholes on Wall Street. That's how it works.
Okay.
我的问题就是相比于北上广深您为什么要选择在成都我感觉这对您来说应该是一个非常重要的决定谢谢我是土生土长的成都人然后我的家人在成都所以我想待在成都离我的家人更近一点，然后呢，这个我觉得中国以后的版图呢，会分为北京的政治，加上上海的资本，再加上深圳的智能硬件，最后是杭州的电商，就差不多这么四个板块。成都是一个非常适合创业的地方。因为生活节奏很慢，它是一个慢生活但是快城市的一种状态。成都的这个创业呢，从政府的支持也好，从人才的引进也好，还有现在所提供的这么一些孵化器，这么一些好的这么一些组织，也是非常适合创业的。但是呢，对我来讲的话，我觉得还有更吸引我的，除了我的家人之外呢，有好吃的，然后呢，有很安逸的生活，然后呢，可以买得起的房子，然后呢，然后呢，这个不用工作20 hours per week， 然后呢，还有这么多的国际友人 ，a lot of foreigners， right？所以我觉得成都是一个非常包容、一个开放的一个城市，和深圳一样，它是一个移民性的城市。那么这个城市的这个年龄也是比较偏年轻化，而且特别的包容。任何人来到了成都，就像张艺谋说的，是一座来了就不想走的城市。所以我觉得选择成都，不论创业、安家，还有这个生活，我觉得都是非常好的选择。所以说，成都常年被选为全国最宜居的城市。
All right,
the biggest challenge.
最大的挑战就是，我每个星期几乎都要从成都飞到北深、上杭这地方去。我觉得最大的挑战就是交通上面这个时间。可能就是说对我来讲的话会耽误了很多时间在路上其实我在想的话看未来能不能够咱们能不能够用一些更高科技的手段比如那个能够飞2倍音速的飞机能够早一点的出现能够大大的节约我们的时间能够少一点的时间和精力花在路上我觉得对我们来讲可能就是最大的挑战在于这其实各种信息交流还有人才我觉得几乎和北京上海来讲的话都是同步的
谢谢他给一个让一个女同胞来问一个问题
big data and bring a lot of advantage
by your sensitive sense?
Well, personally speaking, and our company, we have access to all kinds of data for the companies, and as well as some individuals. You ask the right question. How to use those data? I mean, that's a very important question. And first of all, I mean, gotta be privacy. That will be the privacy issue. And we understand in certain way we cannot use that data. And we cannot treat that data. And the data can only be used for creating the modules, right? I mean, let's say we have a sample of the personal data based on their shopping experience or the shopping records. We can make the prediction, you know, like I mean, for those online shoppers and how much they will spend on an annual basis. But those data are very private. And we know we keep it safe and we draw a line. I mean, not always, not breach the line. So in other words, we do not go cross the line. Okay, I mean, those days, a lot of companies, they have access to all kinds of the data, but how to use that, and in which manner, and how to use that correctly and smartly, I think that's a big issue. So in my opinion, being a big data company, we have to have the correct manners to deal with the data we already acquired.
Sorry, but for some people who live in a very rural and they don't have access to the internet, when you collect data, will this kind of people will be ignored? Or, you know, when you provide your suggestions to the government or companies, you know, is it possible to cover this kind of people?
You mean for the people who do not use the internet?大数据公司来讲的话，它收集的数据都不是最全面的。那么它可能是在某些行业上面有一些侧重或者是一些这个专长的。那么像您刚才说的，在某些地区或者很难用到这个internet这么一些人来讲的话呢，我觉得至少他们是很安全的，因为他们有更少的一些这种隐私被侵犯的可能性。 那么这一块来讲的话呢，就是说我们的这个样本啊是不断的在壮大的，每天收集的数据应该是在 PB 级的。那么这块来讲的话，就是说我们的样本越大的情况下的话，我们的这个做的决策会更准确。我收集的数据越多，我未来的这个决策力做支撑更强大。那么我在想，我们也是三年多才成立三年多的公司。 那在这块来讲的话，我们也会更加的努力去 cover 很多以前没有 cover 到的这么一些地区，或者是这么一些人群，或者是这么一些行业在里面。所以说，我觉得假以时日的话，我们覆盖的这么一些数据和行业的话会更全。那么这样的话，做的一些决策会更准确。OK。
我们后面的朋友有没有问题呢？最后一个问题。One last question。顾总你好，我叫陈立伟，我想请教你一个问题啊，就是你在经历互联网金融危机之后，你破产了，丧失了信用，那你如何重新融资成功，建立自己的企业，并且存活下来？
Well, 这个零八年的时候呢，我没有破产，但是呢，我见了很多人破产。我是在破产的边缘，然后呢，我当时是觉得，中国有很多很多的机会，相对于美国来讲的话呢，中国是正在走上坡路，有大量的不规范性、不规则性，同时也有更多的机会，所以我当时呢就决定呢，还是想回到中国来创业，因为一直心里面都有这么一个梦想，都有这么一下，都觉得人生就是为了干一到两件大事而来，所以呢，当时呢就一直有这个想法，所以呢，最后就回到中国了。回到中国来了以后呢，由于成都确实很安逸，然后呢又是土生土长的成都人，就哪个不想去了，所以在成都呢，以前呢是做过这个节能环保这方面的一个公司，后来呢我把它卖给了这个国企，然后卖给了国企以后呢，就一个机缘巧合，通过这个中科大的校友会认识了中国大数据的领军人物，叫周涛，然后呢周涛呢，涛哥呢和我是同一年的，那么这么认识了以后呢，当时呢就聊得特别的有缘分，而且呢这个一见如故，后来呢我们就一起就做了 BBD 这么一个公司，然后呢这一块呢我当时也是非常的看好，因为当时在大数据和云计算包括物联网都是停留在概念，还没有真正的商业模式的这个阶段，但是我觉得这个我们要有一种前瞻性的眼光去看待，所以我就觉得如果说美国的今天就是我们的明天来看的话，我相信这个是肯定会发生的，只不过是需要一年还是三年的时间我也不知道，先干了再说，就这么一个决定，所以说就这么干。
Okay, that's it. Please give a round of applause. Thanks for coming over. Taking the time. Alright, yeah, this was the third session of Startup Grind in Chengdu. Roy and me, we're also representing another startup organization in Chengdu.